McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents All Are Welcome, How to Build a Real Workplace Culture of Inclusion That Delivers Results by Cynthia Owyoung. Narrated by Raechel Wong. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. Before we talk about anything related to diversity, equity, inclusion, or belonging, or DEIB, we have to talk about why I do this work, which is integral to why I'm writing this book. Like many people who are involved in advocating for DEIB, this is deeply personal for me. What makes it personal, you ask? Let's start with how I define who I am. I am an Asian woman. I am also a first-generation daughter of immigrants from China who came to the United States with very little money and only the promise of the American dream. I have two brothers. One of them is gay. The other is developmentally disabled. I grew up in a lower-middle-class neighborhood where the majority of my neighbors were black. My father served in the Air Force before working his way through community college to become a civil engineer for the city of San Francisco. My mother worked as a seamstress for most of her life, doing piecework at home when I was in elementary school, so she could still take care of us kids. She ultimately transitioned to working full-time in a sewing factory, where she stayed for most of her working life. I am heterosexual, married to a wonderful husband with whom I have two kids. My husband and I both grew up in the Buddhist tradition, and although our kids now go to Catholic school, we consider ourselves atheists. Growing up, I experienced discrimination, harassment, and bias through many different lenses. I saw how my parents struggled with my brother's developmental challenges within a cultural context where disabilities were seen as a source of shame for the family and talking about it was taboo. In one of my most distinct childhood memories, I was maybe 10 years old and sitting at the dining table one night for family dinner. My brother accidentally spilled his cup of milk on the table. My dad immediately yelled at him in Chinese for being stupid and clumsy. My brother's face expressed the worthlessness he felt in that moment. I remember thinking, he doesn't deserve to be yelled at like that. It's just spilled milk. Then, it dawned on me that my father saw it as an indicator of my brother's disability, which led to the overreaction. Witnessing how unfairly my brother was treated because of his disability left an indelible imprint on my heart. This was the seed that led me to pursue a career in DEI and the reason I'm writing this book. Similarly, when my other brother came out as gay to my parents, they couldn't accept it. Thankfully, they didn't disown him or throw him out of the house, as many parents have done with their LGBTQ+ children. But they did tell him not to tell anybody else in the family or flaunt it in any way. They did not want to meet any boyfriend of his or see any gay pride flags flying on his car or at his apartment. My brother was disappointed in their reaction, but honestly, it wasn't a surprise. Because many people at the time, and still to some degree today, consider being LGBTQ+ unnatural, I was just glad that my brother was brave enough to embrace who he is and express it, even if others were not receptive. But what cuts deepest is what he had to go through to get to that place of empowerment. Depression, isolation, years of putting energy into a facade that never seemed right on him. It was a difficult road. I watched him suffer, and I didn't like it. No one should be told who they can and cannot love. And this strong belief underlines why I am motivated to encourage environments of acceptance and inclusion for anyone who might be different from the majority norm. As for myself, I've never felt like I really fit in anywhere. For much of my childhood, I was the odd one out. I was never Chinese enough for my Chinese-speaking friends, and I was definitely not American enough, translation, white, to feel like I fit into American culture. I studied hard at school, but my introverted nature meant I wasn't part of the popular crowd. I tried to fit into the black cliques at school, but I was clearly not one of them either. So where did I fit in? I don't think I really found my community until I was in high school, where I ended up making friends with people who also walked a more multicultural path, either as immigrants themselves or American-born Chinese, or ABCs, like me. I've always felt like I had to carve out my own path as a result, and that perhaps has led to a need to create more connection and a sense of belonging for others. But I've also seen the power of diversity. In middle school, I played in the orchestra. It was probably one of the most diverse orchestras you will ever see, with Black, Latinx, Asian, and white people playing violins, violas, cellos, bass, piano, all mostly in harmony with each other. It didn't matter if you didn't speak English well, as long as you could read music. It didn't matter if you were getting straight A's in class, as long as you showed up for practice. It didn't matter if you didn't have money to afford instruments, since we were all borrowing our instruments from the school. We were taught that music doesn't just come out of the instrument you play. It comes from how you play it, and each of us brought our own special soul to how we played. When we all came together around a piece of music, each playing our different parts and each playing off one another, we created a symphony. I took that experience to heart as a very real and tangible example of how diversity can come together to create something bigger than each individual. The different parts really do make something bigger than the whole. These are just a few examples of many formative experiences that motivated me to become a DEIB professional. Over the years, I've had the good fortune to work at some great companies that have been fully committed to making progress in this space. I was part of the founding diversity and inclusion team at Intuit, where I helped develop and launch their first corporate diversity strategy with company-wide training and employee resource groups, supported by a robust executive diversity council. Then, I got the opportunity to do similar things and more on a global scale at Yahoo, where I was able to expand my scope to include employee engagement programs, talent management, and organizational development work. From there, I led talent development and internal inclusion initiatives at a hypergrowth startup, before leaving to launch my own consulting practice, focused on leadership development for women of color and inclusion strategies for companies. I contracted with companies of all sizes, from biotech to consumer services, helping their DEIB, human resources, and leadership teams develop and implement DEIB strategies. After that, I decided to step out of my comfort zone and enter financial services for the chance to make a difference in an industry that has such a profound impact on economic opportunity. I firmly believe that you cannot have social justice without economic justice as well. So addressing DEIB in financial services has the potential to drive a more equitable society through wealth building in communities that have historically been shut out and left behind. It's a lofty goal that will take more than my lifetime to achieve, but I'm determined to do my part to get us that much closer. Who should listen to this book? While I have been doing this work from within an HR department for all of my career, DEIB is not a uniquely HR function. This playbook is really for any leader of an organization that wants to drive change. In fact, if you're leading a business line or function outside of HR, I really appreciate that you're listening to this book, because ultimately, you are the person who will make the key decisions necessary to determine whether progress will be made. DEIB work is everyone's responsibility, from the frontline worker to the CEO. It will be a journey, and you won't always get things right. As long as I've been doing this work, I've put my foot in my mouth on a regular basis. The field of DEIB is constantly evolving, and what works for one will not work for all. What works today won't necessarily work for tomorrow, and what works for your company won't always work at other companies. Context matters, and it's constantly shifting. Get used to feeling like you don't know everything, because you don't. But if you're persistent, open to experimentation, and willing to admit what you don't know, you just might lead the way for others to follow in driving DEIB for all. How to listen to this book. Being a DEIB practitioner is a hard job. It often feels like you are pushing a rock uphill. And after a while, if you're not able to push that rock up far enough or fast enough, It might feel like it's time to find something else to do before the rock starts rolling back towards you. Many have asked me how I've stayed in this space as long as I have. I tell them I'm extremely stubborn. I won't quit until I've reached my goal of accelerating progress in DEIB across a large swath of corporate America. And that is why this book is important. It's my way of imparting to anyone willing to listen to it all the lessons I've learned doing DEIB work for the past 20 years in companies big and small, across different industries, and within different cultures and conditions for success. This is your playbook for how to approach DEIB work in a way that will support real progress in your companies, if you're truly willing to do what it takes. Keep in mind that I'm not here to give you general platitudes like hire more Black people, or provide you with a list of things to check off like unconscious bias training so you can show others that you're doing something. In my experience, that isn't particularly helpful. My intention is to share the behind-the-scenes actions you need to consider as you actually implement a thoughtful approach to DEIB, and to give you a roadmap of pitfalls to avoid and ways to think about this work that go deeper than surface level. In an effort to protect confidentiality, I've masked identities, changed details, or created a composite of several situations I've encountered in some of the stories shared. My goal is to help you successfully navigate the inherent tension between prioritizing the business and prioritizing DEIB, because they don't always have to be at odds with each other. If your goal is to develop a real culture of inclusion that will result in more dimensions of diversity represented at all levels of your organization, highly engaged employees of all backgrounds being productive and thriving, and a business that is innovative and leading the marketplace, then applying this playbook will help you get there. Please remember that this book is not a step-by-step instruction guide specific to your company or geography. Rather, it is a more general roadmap with guiding principles that you can apply to any situation and modify according to your needs. For example, I'll refer to race and ethnicity, which has a very specific context in the United States, but it will mean something different in other countries and around the world. In your organization, the dimensions of diversity that are important to focus on will vary depending on your demographics, your culture, and your industry, among other factors. It's important to assess your company needs within the broader context it operates in, and develop a set of strategies and a roadmap that is most relevant to you. Within each chapter, I've included exercises to bring these concepts to life and help you begin doing the real work needed to start making progress, building a high-performing workplace culture of diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging. Let's get started. Chapter 1. Defining Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, and Belonging, DEIB. The what, why, and how. When I go to an industry networking event or informal social gathering, I often get asked about what I do for a living, as I'm sure many of us are. When I tell people that I help companies improve their diversity and inclusion, I usually get the follow-up question of, what is that about? So it's worth starting off with the basics of what we mean when we talk about diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, why it's important, and how to diagnose where your issues are. We'll dive into each of these areas in this chapter. What basic terms you need to know. The world of diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging has evolved quite a bit over the years. When I first started looking into careers in this space back in 2000, only large companies had internal personnel dedicated to diversity and inclusion work. At the time, IBM, Sodexo, Charles Schwab, and Genentech were some examples of companies across different industries that had over 10,000 employees and executives directly responsible for creating more diverse and inclusive workplaces. But they were more exceptions to the rule than the rule itself. I remember coming up with only a handful of positions. Back then, most diversity-oriented roles were seen as compliance-based, meaning that companies had to dedicate resources to closing demographic representation gaps because of government regulations to do so. This resulted in many diversity roles being coupled with affirmative action responsibilities. which brings us to our first term, to define. According to the Encyclopedia Britannica, affirmative action in the United States is an active effort to improve employment or educational opportunities for members of minority groups and for women. There are only four dimensions of diversity: gender, race and/or ethnicity, disability, and military status, that firms are legally obligated to measure in the United States through self-identification forms. Within corporations, affirmative action is often misinterpreted as requiring quotas for hiring people based on these demographic characteristics, without regard to whether they are the most qualified people for the job or not. This interpretation has formed the most common argument against diversity efforts, which is that in a meritocracy, only your ability should determine whether you are selected for a role or able to advance inside a company. Your demographic background shouldn't matter. It's all about objective qualifications. However, both viewpoints are flawed because affirmative action isn't about hiring quotas, and true meritocracies don't exist. What affirmative action actually means in practice is that companies required by law to adhere to this policy must make good faith efforts to attain representation parity between their workforce and whatever the available qualified talent pools are within the geographical area from which they recruit for each job category within the company. Good faith efforts essentially means that companies have to take actions to try to close any representation gaps that might exist. It does not mean that they have to hire people based only on their race or gender. Affirmative action and diversity are two separate and distinct concepts. While many companies engage in affirmative action as a matter of compliance with U.S. federal laws, it's not the same thing as driving diversity in the workplace. While affirmative action and diversity are both about representation, affirmative action is more limited in its scope. The rules that U.S. federal government contractors must adhere to in support of affirmative action are designed to span across all industries, and, therefore, the rules meet the lowest common denominator. In other words, while affirmative action analyses and plans can be incredibly useful inputs to diversity strategies and efforts, they only go so far, and they must be supplemented by other activities that go beyond limited representation. Diversity in the context of a workplace really means bringing people who are different from each other, with their own unique characteristics, backgrounds, experiences, and perspectives, together to realize the strengths of those differences. It encompasses much more than just race and gender, which are often the focus of affirmative action, and it demands that people think more broadly about the various dimensions of diversity that can be leveraged for success. The model shown in Figure 1.1 is one that I've often referenced in my work and found particularly helpful. It was created by Lee Gardenswartz and Anita Rowe, who have been pioneers in diversity education since 1977. The model describes the five layers of global diversity, using concentric circles to illustrate how we are all made up of various dimensions of diversity. Your personality is at the core, followed by a ring of internal dimensions as defined by your demographics, like race, age, and gender. The next circle shows the external dimensions that shape who you are, like education and income. The circle after that shows the organizational dimensions, which encompass characteristics typically used to define yourself at work, like job level or work location. Finally, the outermost circle, countries of operation, consists of dimensions defining the cultures in which you operate, including language, laws, and values that affect your cultural viewpoint. Each person has a unique perspective that is informed by each of these layers. Growing up in the United States, I have a very different lens on DEIB than I would have if I had grown up in China, as my parents did. Having a marketing background means I do not look at employee issues in the same way as my colleagues who have been in only human resources. And being able-bodied means I don't experience accessibility issues to physical environments in the way that people with mobility issues do. There are many characteristics we use to define our identities, and it's important to recognize that each person has both visible and invisible identities that we may not be aware of. Being cognizant of how different contexts inform different perspectives is incredibly important to developing an appropriate action plan that is inclusive of and relevant to different issues. You often see diversity and inclusion used together in a phrase, and indeed, the two concepts go together, but they are not interchangeable. Diversity refers to representation across characteristics that make people who they are. And inclusion actually means ensuring that no one is held back from full participation within the organization. Inclusion strives to leverage diversity within the organization to its fullest potential. An analogy I love that delineates really succinctly the difference between diversity and inclusion was coined by Verna Myers, the current VP of Inclusion Strategy at Netflix. Diversity is being invited to the party. Inclusion is being asked to dance. I remember how important it was for me to be asked to dance when I was considering whether to take an executive diversity and inclusion, or D&I, role. I realized that I would be the only person of color at that level in human resources at the company. And while I was not reporting directly to the Chief Human Resources Officer, CHRO, I would still be a member of the HR leadership team responsible for making HR policy and program decisions affecting the company. That I would be on the HR leadership team was a key reason why I decided to take the role. Not only did the company give me a leadership seat at the table, but I felt strongly included during meetings where I could fully participate and have my perspective taken seriously. This is a very real example of why having diversity is not enough. It must also be coupled with inclusion to reap the benefits of what that diversity brings to your organization. It's relatively easy to bring diversity into an organization. It's much harder to create a truly inclusive culture in which that diversity wants to stay. When did equity, E, and belonging, B, join? For many decades, the field focused only on diversity and inclusion. But in recent years, companies have started to add in some newer terms to ensure that diversity goes beyond just checking off that box. Equity is the key outcome of driving for more diversity and inclusion within an organization. Equity is often confused with equality because they both seek the same outcome: fair treatment for everyone. However, where equality is about everyone getting the same opportunities, access, and resources, equity acknowledges that not everyone needs the same things to succeed. Equity is about giving people what they need. At one company, they made a concerted effort to hire people who came from non-traditional industry backgrounds into entry-level customer service roles. Historically, they had tended to favor people with prior experience in that industry. However, what they found was that the people who ultimately succeeded the most in these roles weren't people who had prior knowledge or experience. Rather, it was the people who really enjoyed building relationships with customers and helping them. But after hiring these folks, it became clear that they were not passing the required training certifications, another important step in their success, at the same rates as those with backgrounds in the industry. This was negatively affecting their ability to retain more underrepresented groups, including women and ethnic minorities, who made up a bigger proportion of those without prior industry experience. Consequently, they set out to redesign their training process to allow for different timeframes and types of support, like mentoring, aligned to people at different levels of industry knowledge and experience. This resulted in more consistent pass rates across different demographics. This was equity in action, giving people different resources based on their individual circumstances and needs. The cartoon in Figure 1.2 really illustrates this difference. A more recent concept to be connected to diversity and inclusion in the workplace is the idea of belonging. Belonging is the sense of connection one has to a group. Do I feel like I fit in? Am I considered a valued member of the team? Will they accept me for who I am? Belonging is highly related to inclusion in that you can't have belonging without inclusion. It's one thing to be welcomed initially into a group. It's quite another thing to feel like this is a group you are comfortable staying in for the long term. The longest job I ever stayed in was at Yahoo. It was a place where I felt a strong sense of belonging, where employees were united in the sense of being underdogs in the tech industry, trying to survive in a Google-dominated world. The employees at Yahoo described themselves as bleeding purple, the company's brand color, to signify how strongly they connected to the company and its mission. In addition to that, I had the rare experience of serving under two female CEOs at the tech company, and there were many Asians in leadership roles throughout my tenure, which signaled that significant barriers for people like me to climb the corporate ladder did not exist. The company's culture and values really spoke to me, and I appreciated feeling like I wasn't limited in what I could achieve there. My sense of belonging to the company was so strong that even now, more than 5 years since leaving the company, I still tell people that I bleed purple and will never give up my Yahoo email account. That's the power of belonging. Other important concepts. Another term that's important to talk about is underrepresented groups, URGs, an umbrella term used historically to refer to marginalized communities, including women, people of color, people with disabilities, LGBTQ+ people, and anyone else who isn't fully represented in the workplace. You'll notice I use this term extensively instead of minorities, because it is much broader than just race or ethnicity, which is typically what minorities refers to. I also encourage you to stay away from referring to underrepresented groups as diverse communities. Every community is diverse, based on the definition of diversity I gave earlier. Rather than using diverse communities as a way of avoiding saying black or brown people, or any other dimension that makes you feel uncomfortable being specific about, it's preferable to speak directly to the issues we are trying to solve for, which, at their core, are underrepresentation and inequitable treatment. Many companies define their efforts even more specifically around BIPOC, which stands for Black, Indigenous, and People of Color communities, in an effort to center their needs. Lastly, we can't talk about underrepresentation and inequitable treatment without also talking about bias. Bias is defined as a tendency or inclination in favor of or against an idea or thing, usually in a way that is perceived as unfair. We all have biases, both conscious and unconscious. These are sometimes referred to as explicit versus implicit, respectively, where explicit refers to biases that we express intentionally, and implicit refers to biases that we are not necessarily fully aware of, and that are often unintentional. Some biases are good, like choosing to eat healthy food, and some biases are not so good, like assuming an older person can't use technology. Having biases doesn't make anyone a bad person. In fact, biases are part of being human and are largely helpful to us in that they are cognitive shortcuts that allow us to make quicker sense of the world. We just need to be careful about ensuring that our biases don't lead to inaccurate or unreasonable conclusions about people. It is one of the underlying reasons why some people are more advantaged or disadvantaged than others. We tend to feel more positive toward people we perceive to be more like ourselves, and ascribe more positive traits to people we are comfortable and familiar with. It's important to raise our awareness of the different types of biases we have, and take steps to mitigate or counteract potential negative impacts from them where possible. There are a ton of other DEIB-related terms that would take more than one book to explain. But if you're serious about DEIB work, get to know terms like cisgender, cultural appropriation, and intersectionality, among others. I recommend starting with the Harvard Office for Diversity, Inclusion, and Belonging's DEIB glossary, Foundational Concepts and Affirming Language, and branching out from there. Do your research online and look for reputable and varied sources. One of the questions I am asked most often is, what are the most appropriate terms to use when referring to insert diversity characteristic here? I recognize that diversity-related terminology can sometimes feel like a minefield. No one wants to offend people inadvertently, and it's easy to do when you're not well-versed in the right language. But it's important to understand that language is an ever-evolving construct, and what is acceptable terminology today might not be 10 years from now. Take the word handicap to describe a person with a disability, for example. A few decades ago, this was the acceptable term. However, as more people equated the meaning of handicapped as tied to begging on the streets with cap in hand, it became offensive to use the term when describing a person with a disability. As a general rule of thumb, it's much more acceptable to use person-first terminology, with which you recognize the person first, then the disability. So, instead of saying a blind person, you would say a person who is blind. It's also important to note that what one person finds acceptable, another may not. Some people identify as a person with a disability, but others prefer to identify as differently abled. Some people identify as black, and others prefer to be referred to as African American. It's really not about getting terminology right all the time, but, instead, about using the most broadly acceptable terms when referring to a group, and making the effort to ask individuals how they would prefer to be identified when you are interacting with them. It can be really helpful to read first-person accounts of why someone prefers one term over another. Keep in mind that what works in one context might be received differently in another, but don't let that stop you from getting started on your own journey of discovery. Putting it into action. Think about a time when you felt excluded in your life. How did it make you feel? Come up with a word or short phrase to describe the emotion that most dominates that memory. Ask a few of your friends to do the same exercise and share their emotion words with you. Do you see any commonalities among the words shared? I've asked this question of various individuals and groups dozens of times throughout the years, and I've seen many of the same words come up over and over again. Frustration, embarrassment, sadness, isolation, anger, loneliness, and so on. If you or people on your team were coming into work every day feeling any of these emotions, do you think they would be very productive? I don't think they would be. Is it fair to expect people feeling this way to be performing at their best? No, it's not. But that is what we ask people to do when we don't address the latest harassment or discrimination headline in our workplaces. Do situations of exclusion happen only to people in underrepresented groups? I think you would be hard-pressed to find anyone who hasn't experienced a single time in their lives where they felt excluded. This is why DEIB work is so relevant to everyone in every workplace. It's not just an underrepresented group problem to solve. It's everyone's problem to solve. Why is DEIB so important? I mentioned earlier that relatively few companies were hiring for DEIB roles 20 years ago. For someone who is trying to break into the field with no professional background in HR, at a time when the first dot-com bubble had just burst, causing havoc in the marketplace, and kicking off a recession that was then exacerbated by the events of September 11, 2001, it is a bit of an understatement to say that it was a challenge to make the transition to a DEIB career. These kinds of roles were few and far between, and it took me 2 years of contracting, networking, and volunteering to finally land that elusive full-time diversity role at a tech company within commuting distance of my home. Contrast that with today, when a search for inclusion and diversity job titles on Indeed.com yields 84 jobs available in the San Francisco Bay Area alone. Companies as small as 100 people now have diversity committees, and it seems any company doing any significant volume in hiring either already has or is currently looking for at least one diversity role in-house. According to LinkedIn, the number of diversity roles at organizations grew by 71% in just 5 years, from 2015 to 2020. This is good news. Over the years, company leaders have woken up to the fact that they need to focus on DEIB. Maybe you're one of them, since you've decided to listen to this book. Or maybe you're just curious about the topic and haven't yet thought about why DEIB should be important to your company. Whatever your starting point, you need to understand the business case for diversity and develop one for your own organization to motivate stronger engagement and progress. First things first, let's establish right off the bat that doing DEIB work is the morally right thing to do. If we believe everyone has the same basic human rights, then equal access to opportunities for everyone and the basic right to respect and dignity should be a no-brainer. Therefore, every company should be striving for equal representation in their ranks and an inclusive environment for all to thrive and belong. But every company isn't actually doing that, so we know that moral arguments only go so far. While fundamentally, I think business cases for DEIB shouldn't be necessary and are used more often as excuses for inaction, I also believe we should treat DEIB initiatives just like any other business initiative within a company. And that means developing a business case to justify resourcing against it. Developing a business case means answering a few simple questions. 1. What problem am I trying to solve? 2. What are the benefits of solving it? 3. What resources will be needed to solve it? What am I solving for? Let's start with defining the problem. First, create a macro view of the business problem. It doesn't take much effort to find some sobering statistics on the state of diversity in business from either a local or global lens. You should also research diversity statistics specific to your industry through government sources, academic and non-governmental organizations, and/or professional organizations. Here is just a sampling of studies that highlight the gaps in representation of various dimensions of diversity across the business landscape. From 2000 to 2020, there was little increase in the Fortune 500 CEO diversity. White men held 96.4% of the Fortune 500 CEO positions in 2000, and they still held 85.8% in 2020. Only 1% of the Fortune 500 CEOs in 2020 were African Americans. Only 2.4% were East Asians or South Asians, and only 3.4% were Latinx. Women accounted for less than a third, 29%, of senior roles globally in 2019. Across 34 countries surveyed by the Pew Research Center in 2019, a median of 52% agreed that homosexuality should be accepted, with 38% saying that it should be discouraged. In developing countries, according to the United Nations, as recently as 2021, 80 to 90% of persons with disabilities of working age were unemployed, whereas in industrialized countries, the figure was between 50 and 70%. In the United States, Black and Hispanic workers have continued to be underrepresented in the STEM workforce. According to Pew Research in 2018, Black people made up 11% of the U.S. workforce overall, but represented 9% of STEM workers, while Hispanic people made up 16% of the U.S. workforce, but only 7% of all STEM workers. After looking at the overall statistics, you should assess your own organization with a diversity lens to understand any gaps in representation, inclusion experiences, or diverse market needs that may affect your business which need to be addressed. You're really looking for areas where there may be an unintentional disparate impact happening, meaning one group of people is being disproportionately affected by a system, process, or policy that is intended to affect everyone equally. For example, your hiring process may be unintentionally screening out people who are neurodivergent if it requires taking an exam that means sitting still for 2 hours, which can be really challenging for someone on the autism spectrum. I worked with a tech company that had a 4-hour technical screen that we found was disparately affecting mothers who were turned off from applying because their family responsibilities deterred them from spending that much time on a technical assignment that might not lead to anything worthwhile. Your firm may already be collecting information on basic demographics, such as age and gender, for benefits administration. If your firm is also a federal contractor in the United States, or subject to rules similar to affirmative action in other countries, you may be required to collect race and/or ethnicity information, disability status, and military status. You could also supplement that information with other dimensions of diversity, like sexual orientation, gender identity, national origin, or caretaking status. This can be accompanied through regular surveys to your employees or as part of your onboarding process during hiring. The key is to focus on dimensions that will be relevant to your DEIB goals. You don't want to measure something for measurement's sake. For example, asking about gender pronouns allows you to address people correctly in emails and during meetings. That is a specific action you can take to help people feel included. However, asking people to identify whether they are bisexual or pansexual isn't likely to be helpful when your actions to support people who identify in either category are not likely to be any different, such as policies prohibiting discrimination and harassment based on sexual orientation. Probably the most difficult concepts to measure are inclusion and belonging, because that is a very personal experience for each individual. The most common indicators for this are employee surveys and attrition rates. In employee surveys, you can ask questions specifically about how strongly people feel they belong inside their teams, or if they feel included in decision-making. Oftentimes, it can be helpful to create or leverage existing diversity climate surveys and inclusion indexes used by many other companies as benchmarks for comparison. Attrition is the natural outcome of employees not feeling like they belong at a company. There are usually many factors that weigh into a decision to leave a company, but if you can correlate attrition and exit survey results with inclusion and belonging survey items, there is a lot of validity in using attrition as an indicator of inclusion issues that need to be addressed. Don't discount qualitative feedback from your employees. If you have open feedback channels for employees to submit questions about DEIB, you can gather information about what's on their minds in real time. You can also hold periodic focus groups or attend employee community meetings to hear more about what's going well and what might be challenging. Monitoring the kinds of employee relations issues that come into legal and HR.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.